At last, episode 32, which covers the end of May through mid-July 1988. Only 12 games this time, because we've got the last two parts of the massive history of adventure games. Speaking of which, we have a weird adventure game from Konami, some oddball games from Mysterious Westerner, and finally, some high-quality stuff from Sunsoft. So let's get going. Okay, we'll start off with the final game of May 1988. Unfortunately, it's Ninja-kun, Ashura no Sho, from UPL. Ninja-kun? Remember him? Cute little ninja guy? This is what, the fourth game with Ninja-kun in it? Well, there'll be plenty more. Now, first things first. The first Ninja-kun game was based on a UPL arcade game and was released for the Famicom by Jalico. Then Jalico spun off its own series of original titles under the name Ninja Jajamaru, who was supposedly Ninja-kun's little brother. Then in 1987, UPL suddenly put an arcade sequel to the first game, perhaps inspired by the success of the Jalico games. This was known as Ninja Kid 2, or even better, the wonderfully 80s-sounding title Rad Action. It's basically an updated version of Ninja-kun with a few bells and whistles added, nothing too exciting. A couple new kinds of levels and some incredibly psychedelic graphics. Now UPL has ported this to the Famicom. Because the quality is important, they hired the very best, Micronix, to program the Famicom version. And man is this thing ugly. It just goes to show everything Micronix gets their hands on, they turn into a huge mess. So anyway, this game has some sort of like branching path feature where you can select which level you actually want to start at the beginning of the game. The object here is still to kill all the enemies on screen. You can stun them by jumping at them, or to kill them you have to use your throwing stars or one of the power-ups that you get. The arcade game is pretty old-fashioned by 1987 standards, not there's anything wrong with that, but it does mean it plays more like a game from a few years back, feels kind of out of place with the RPGs and run and guns coming out on the Famicom. Now there are some very irritating moments. You have this bonus-like level, where you need to perform some rapid button mashing to climb up a wall. However, it's too easy to fall off the wall, and when you do, you'll land on the exit, and then you'll be asked if you want to quit the level. I mean, this is so idiotic. It's so easy to fall off the wall, and you keep landing on that door, and then having to talk to this guy over and over again. Since you're always going to land on it when you fall, why not move it over? It's just completely bizarre level design here. Anyway, once you do finally make this, you get a boomerang weapon, and you then get the not-so-psychedelic congratulations screen. It's a bit less exciting than the arcade version. Now, it turns out this was going to be released in the US by American Sammy under the name Ninja Taro. It's actually listed in Nintendo Power as having a spring 1988 release date, though it wouldn't have looked too impressive next to Mega Man 2, Strider, and Super Dodgeball. The release was cancelled, but in 1991, Sammy released a game for the Game Boy called Ninja Taro. But it turns out this was a completely different game. It was like a Zelda clone. I guess the name Ninja Taro was too good not to use. So anyway, Ninja-kun Ashura no Sho, not a terrible, terrible game, but the original arcade game was not that exciting, and the Famicom port is really not even as good as that. And the last game of May 1988 is Saint Seiya 2. Well, that's what GameFAQs calls it. From Bandai and Tosa, though the animated series was from Toei, so we should be grateful that Bandai made the game as opposed to Toei using Shoei System to put out a Saint Seiya game. Now here's a money-saving tip for video game developers. When making a sequel, use the exact same intro and opening music as the first game. Just add a new title screen. Well, actually, the music does sound maybe just a little bit better. Alright, so anyway, can't remember what Saint Seiya is? Well, can't say I blame ya. It's about these kids who were raised to be super warriors called saints, who have this sort of special Greek mythology powers and protect the goddess Athena. Naturally, it has something to do with some gods, and then stuff happens, Oh yeah, and there's these magical bronze armor called cloths. Yes, cloths is the official word for the armors. So don't blame the translators of this game if that sounds weird. And yes, this is a fine translation from the same folks who translated Gegege no Kotaro 2. However, the translation cannot save this game. So, looks kinda boring, huh? Punch the bad guys who just sort of wander around randomly, jump and land on ya, walk right into the bottomless pits that are all over the place. The game alternates between these little side-scrolling sequences with menu-based boss battles. Menu-based, you say? Why, yes. Would it surprise you to learn that there are RPG elements in Saint Seiya 2? It wouldn't. Well, then I guess you are starting to get the hang of things. This guy's all like, oh no you didn't. Looks like a boss battle, but actually it's not. You can't attack him, you just talk to him. And he'll fix your claws or something like that. Many tiny scratches. Apparently all this is based very closely on the animated series. Now we'll move on to level 2. A couple things. Each level you can choose what character you want to play, some are better than others against certain bosses. You have 2 meters, Cosmo. It's not the drink or the magazine, it's like Saint Seiya's version of the Force. You also have health. You can go around killing enemies and racking up 7th sense, which you can use to refill your Cosmo and health. So the Saints are basically vampires who stay alive by consuming the life force of the people they murdered. Oh yeah, and by the way, that was level 2. Looks exactly like level 1. Battles, you can talk, fight, or switch characters. Talking actually sometimes is required. So you have 2 different attacks. Is there a difference? Maybe? It's not like one does more consistent damage than the other as far as I can tell. Now here's the thing, bosses do tons of damage, so when they attack, you want to try to dodge, using the left button. I don't know exactly if you how the mechanic works, because sometimes I could dodge, other times nothing seems to happen. I assume there's some sort of window of time, but I don't see any on-screen indication as to when you should try to dodge. Maybe if you play this game, you'll have better luck than me. And when you defeat this guy, a little teeny-tiny piece of his horn falls off. Very dramatic. So if you get this far and don't hate Saint Seiya yet, we're going to hear. Because it requires a lot of jumping, and the jumping is terrible. You have no control over the jump while in midair. Sometimes when you jump like way far. Other times you jump like just 1 pixel forward. It's really difficult to control, and you're going to fall to your deaths many, many times. And oddly enough, you jump further from a standstill as opposed to doing a running jump. Now, I didn't really get too far in this game, namely because I couldn't get past this boss. He hits you for like 50 damage every time he attacks, but you only do like about 20 damage to him. And frequently, my attacks would actually do no damage. And dodging consistently is probably the key, but I simply could not do that. No loss, because apparently this game is very repetitive and all the levels are sort of the same. And the RPG elements don't really seem to like amount to much. It's basically just a power bar that you can fill up. And there's actually a lot less variety in this than in the first game, so you can probably safely skip this one. We enter June with a very interesting game. Along with Blaster Master, this is certainly the best game this episode. Cosmo Police Galvan from Nihon Busan, aka Nichibutsu. Now this is one of those hidden Japanese gems you always hear about, which has been given a very helpful English fan translation. Here's the backstory. Sounds a lot like the plot of Halo, quite frankly. Now before we get any further, let's provide a little bit of background. Uchu Keiji Gavin was the first in a long-running series of Toei TV shows. Originally ran back in 1982. Pretty exciting stuff, as you can see. The story is that Earth has been invaded by an evil alien empire, and this guy is going to save mankind or something. Confusingly, the title is generally translated as Space Sheriff Gavin. However, Nichibutsu gave this game the English title of Cosmo Police Galavan. Oh well. The game first appeared in arcades in 1985, a typical ghosts and goblins type platformer. even the one with laser guns and space armor as power-ups. This is a pretty natty-looking game, though it doesn't really bear too much resemblance to the Famicom game we're going to see today. You always know they're bad guys when the entrance to their headquarters is shaped like a dragon's head. So anyway, you just march in there even without your metal armor, armed only with your beam blade, which I guess is like a lightsaber. A tiny, short lightsaber. For the Famicom version of Cosmo Police Caliban, Nichi Butsu decided to completely revamp it as like a Metroid-style game, with, you guessed it, RPG elements. Yep, there's levels, experience, hit points, Cosmo points, which are used when you fire special weapons, and GP. Don't know what GP stands for, Galavan points maybe? But you get metal armor when it fills up. Just like Metroid, you need to collect various upgrades to make any progress. First up is the Hyper Ray, used to open locked doors. That guy just gave it to me. Only problem is when you try to fire it, well, you have no Cosmo points. So go ahead and randomly kill some enemies until they drop some Cosmo points. Enemies will always drop HP, CP, or GP. Which one do they drop? Well, it's based on the Zelda rule. Whatever you're already maxed out on or don't need, that's what they'll drop. Or at least that's what it feels like. Oh, also note, every time you kill an enemy, you get one experience point. Woohoo. This factors in both your level and your weapons level. Yeah, this game makes you level up your weapons. Okay, so finally got some CP there, so I'll use that Hyper Ray to just open the door, and then I'll enter a new area. Now those guys have laser guns or something like that. You're also going to need to destroy this, like, supercomputer in order to open some more doors. Then you're going to actually need to find another weapon, the Metal Blade, then obtain the Cosmo Power, and defeat, I believe, a total of three sub-bosses and one final boss. All in the first level, so it's actually a little confusing. You need to be very careful and avoid the computer's projectiles because they'll knock off a huge chunk of your hit points. Galavan kinda reminds me of Kid Icarus in that you are sort of criminally underpowered at the game's beginning. It's sometimes impossible to fight enemies without getting hit. Once you get the Cosmo Power, you can use your beam to deflect their shots, so that makes it a little bit easier. Take these guys for example. They fire an unblockable shot at your feet. Normally you can try to jump over the shot, but he's under a platform and you can't jump. And on the upper platform you'll take damage if your head hits the top. So you often need to sort of use up your valuable CP points if you don't want to take damage. Which reminds me of something that's true of both Metroid and Kid Icarus. They gave you a ranged weapon. Not this little tiny short lightsaber that takes like 5 hits to kill anything. Oh yeah, and Galavan has a bad case of what the TV tropes would call goddamn bats, and they're much worse here than the bats in Castlevania. Unlike Castlevania, these bats take like 6 hits to kill, so even if you get in several good hits, they'll still fly right through you and cause some damage, then turn around and hit you again. I officially declare Galavan's bats, and the bats in Battle of Olympus, to be the worst video game bats I've seen so far. Ah, here's the first boss. All the bosses take like a lot of hits to kill. These bosses try to wear you out. You have to sort of find their pattern and run up without getting hit and do it over and over and over again. I swear, a normal ranged weapon or a longer weapon would make a big difference. If I had Belmont's Whip, I could totally school these bosses. But in order to have any chance of killing enemies, you need to level up your weapons. Yeah, you see, every sword needs to be leveled up from grade C to grade A. You have 6 swords plus a final sword. Each new sword requires more experience to level up. In other words, you need to grind in this game. As you can see, I'm doing it this particular spot right here. I added up the total experience required to level all the swords up to their maximum, and it would be like a minimum of 4,200 points. Remember, regular enemies drop just 1 point, so there's no way you'd come even close to that playing the game through normally. So I guess you're sort of forced to grind. Well, slowly getting there, had to get 300 points to level that one up. Now, Cosmo Police Galavan doesn't really go full Metroid, meaning having one gigantic level. No, it's broken down into 6 discrete levels. Developers don't seem to want to take that step of making everything one gigantic level. The game reminds me quite a bit of that crazy Bio Senshi Dan game from Atlus, but even more involved. Maybe even a bit too involved. As I mentioned, you have to collect new weapons, crystals, upgrades, and etc. at every single level. And levels aren't really huge. Opening passages is sometimes a bit obscure. You have to use like a crystal at some particular part to open up a new passage somewhere else in the level. And again, destroying the computer will open up another passage somewhere in the level. And you won't always know where the new opening is. It sort of appears out of nowhere. It's not like anything like obvious, like a blocked passage or something like that. Well, despite all my bitching and complaining, Galvan's an unusually well-made game. I mean, it has high-quality graphics, cool-looking bosses, great catchy music. I could really do without the experience grinding and the stupidity of the short weapon, but still highly recommended and one of the better games of this sort. I don't know why this was not released in the US. Other Nichibutsu games like Mag Max came out over here. So anyway, definitely give this one a try. Chowakusei Senkei Metafight, or Superplanetary War Chronicle Metafight, from Sunsoft. What's a metafight? That's a fight about fighting, I suppose. Though, of course, this shot of a super space tank blasting off immediately identifies this game as Blaster Master. The Japanese version didn't have any sort of in-game plot summary, so here in the US we got a very spiffy new intro. Metafight used the standard video game plot, evil alien invaders, it's up to you to defend your planet, the very same story in every single shoot-'em-up ever. However, in a fit of whimsy, Sunsoft decided to make Blaster Master about a guy who has a barrel of radioactive waste in his backyard. When his pet fraud escapes, he discovers a hidden tunnel to the underground world full of mutants. So he hops in the nearby super tank to end the threat to mankind. Wait a second, where did the tank come from? The manual just sort of glosses over the whole tank thing. Now everyone says the tank is named Sophia the Third, but neither the game nor the manual ever states this. The manual just calls it the vehicle. Sophia the Third is the planet's name in the original game. Regardless, Sophia, or whatever she's called, is a pretty awesome tank. Able to fire left, right, or straight up, and capable of jumping. Later you get all sorts of upgrades to Sophia. You see, Blaster Master is a Metroid-type game, one with tons of exploration, backtracking, unlocking new passageways, the whole nine yards. One thing I really like about this game is the way that the graphics sort of give you like a wide-angle view of the landscape. It's sort of like the camera has been pulled back a bit. It's like a side-scroller in long shot rather than medium shot. The game is divided into two types of gameplay. There's the side-scrolling tank sections and the top-down Zelda-esque sections. You see, Jason will occasionally need to exit the vehicle and walk around on foot. I can't think of any other games that allow you to do this. Oh, that's right. Paris-Dakar Rally Special. Okay, well, Master Blaster is slightly better than that game. So basically, you make your way through these little mazes, shoot up some enemies, and usually try to find like some special helpful items, like the flashing P will refill your power. I just picked up some missiles for the tank. Each level has a few of these mazes, but one in particular will actually have a boss. You need to defeat this boss to get an upgrade for your tank. This guy is called Mother Brain. I guess Blaster Master is not really shy about wearing its influences on his sleeve. Once you defeat him, you'll get a more powerful tank cannon, which allows you to blow up an enemy blocking the way to level 2. Ah, there it is right there. You'll then very conveniently warp back to the beginning of the maze. You can hop back in the tank and it'll automatically install your upgrade. Notice the hyper there. Now level 2 is a bit different. It's sort of a castle themed level, one full of lava pits and enemies that you can't hit with your cannon because they're too small. The shells just fly over their heads. There's those things that look kind of like little gray caterpillars. Yeah, this game loves to throw difficult to hit enemies at you. Good idea to stock up on homing missiles. Now the bosses are all large and mostly pretty cool looking. Some of them can be difficult and irritating. Sadly, as much as I like Blaster Master, it's not a perfect game and a few small problems do pop up. For example, there are sometimes enemies at the bottom of the screen that seem to have turned invisible. You actually can't see these guys until you jump off a ledge and are halfway about to land on them. And the top-down sections are often considered to be inferior to the tank sections, mostly because it's so difficult to hit enemies. The collision detection is very weird. I was firing point-blank at that guy and somehow missing him. You often see bullets go right through an enemy's head. Same thing here with the bosses. You're supposed to hit him in the mouth when his mouth is open, but the hitbox must be about 1 pixel. Nothing is registering a hit. It doesn't help that the grenades have incredibly short range and no splash damage at all. Which doesn't really make much sense. I mean, they're grenades. Now, once your gun is fully powered up, it's pretty powerful, but here's the thing. When you take damage from an enemy, not only do you lose life, but you also lose gunpowder as well. Which means that a few hits and your gun becomes a completely worthless pea shooter. And again, here, look at the way the bolts just go right through that guy. And your tank is equipped with 3 special weapons, used by holding down the D-pad and then firing. The homing missiles are far and away the most effective, so useful for shooting enemies your cannon can't reach. The H icon is for hover. After level 3, you need to get a hover upgrade, meaning your tank can briefly fly a bit. It's needed to get to the top of a cliff to the entrance level 4, but hovering uses up hover energy very quickly, so you can't use it very often. And the game has 8 levels, all quite distinct and large, including this cool underground sewer level. The background graphics are quite good, and everything looks very atmospheric, and levels all feel sort of dangerous. Definitely the most grueling level is the underwater one. When you enter the water, Sophia sinks like a stone, so you need to leave the tank and make your way to the boss's lair by yourself. And you'll miss not having all of Sophia's weaponry on this level, since you're quite weak. The final boss here will be a giant crab boss that will drop an upgrade that allows Sophia to operate underwater. So an upgrade that allows you to travel underwater, a lot of later games use this, like Metroid Prime. Is Blaster Master the first time this appears in a video game? A later upgrade allows you to climb walls, again necessary to get to the next level. Another thing about Blaster Master, the in-game world is quite big and backtracking is required. After completing level 3, you need to go all the way back to the beginning of level 1 to reach level 4. Some people complain about this, but there are a few shortcuts to be found. And the manual actually tells you how levels are linked together, so it's not like you should be completely in the dark. For those of you who only have the cartridge or are playing on an emulator, you might want to look up a map online. So there's the usual ice levels, with three ledges, the lava level that we see here, and so on. Now when you enter the last level, you'll get an upgrade that allows you to climb ceilings as well, so you can pretty much drive everywhere once you have that. Now as cool as that is, it can be a bit tricky, because you often want to make a jump if you're on a ledge, but you end up climbing around the bottom of the ledge instead. This level here is perhaps the toughest. Those spiky things will kill you very quickly, and you have to have some hover energy left in order to make certain narrow jumps. And if you fail to shoot down those caterpillar guys before they land, things will get real ugly real quick. Touching enemies doesn't damage them, and you have no grace and vulnerability. So an enemy can move in the same direction as you while touching you and do constant damage. Now I should point out, this game is hard. It's long, complicated, has tough bosses, which you fight with lousy weapons, and incredibly, there's no passwords or battery save options. You have to complete it in one sitting. That's an extremely bad decision on Sunsoft's part. You also have limited continues. You know, I look up a speedrun for Blaster Master, and it's 42 minutes, over twice as long as Metroid, and quite a bit longer than Zelda or Symphony of the Night. Oh, that's the final boss right there, the guy in the box cover. Very impressive looking, but it turns out he's not, of course, the real final boss. That's actually this guy. The first guy we saw a second ago, he has those spears that he spits out that does big damage. And he can only get hit a couple times before dying. Luckily, this last boss here is he's a bit easier to avoid because your health does not regenerate between bosses. Apparently about 150 grenade hits are required to kill him, according to one fact I read. So anyway, despite my myriad complaints, Blaster Master really is a great game, and one of those games that 8-bit gaming aficionados just love. If it were made by Konami, that would be no surprise, but the amazing thing is it doesn't quite resemble any of Sunsoft's earlier game. Oh yeah, one thing here. How did he get Fred back, and what exactly caused his hair to turn green? Anyway, there is a sudden huge leap in quality and ambition shown here, which is very impressive. I guess there's a certain amount of mystery around the game, like who exactly worked Takai Engineering, and who is the Fanky who's listed as the game designer. Well, hopefully the golden age of Sunsoft is now upon us. The Sunsoft of Batman, Euphoria, and Gimmick instead of the Sunsoft of Superboy Allen. And one last thing, check out the bad English in the congratulations screen. Great stuff. Well, that is Blaster Master. Hopefully, if you've never played this game, give it a try. Ready for some classic shoot-em-up action from Capcom? Well, I guess I wouldn't really call this classic, but it is pretty decent. 1943, The Battle of Midway, is the sequel to 1942, Capcom's early shoot-em-up originally released in arcades in 1984. In the 1940 series, you control a P-38 that attempts to single-handedly destroy the Japanese Navy. 1943 reportedly takes place during the Battle of Midway. So what was the Battle of Midway? An important naval battle that took place off the Midway Atoll, smack dab in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. Japan didn't want us to have a base of operations to launch attacks towards Asia, so they planned to take the Midway Islands. However, the Japanese naval code had been broken and the US Navy was able to get reinforcements in time, and Japan ended up losing all four of its aircraft carriers sent to battle. The defeat was so bad, the Japanese Imperial Navy lied and said they won for propaganda purposes. And oh yeah, it took place in June 1942. Now the arcade game, seen here, came out in 1987. It was similar to 1942, but with some modern features. More power-ups, a life bar, and even end-of-level bosses. He got some pretty cool weapons like the spread shot and the shotgun. The only thing was, special weapons would disappear when their timer ran out, and your health bar was slowly decreasing as well. It was possible to end up not defeating the boss if you didn't damage a certain percentage of him quickly enough. Still, it was a pretty cool game. For the home version, you start by assigning points to your attributes. What's that, attributes? Unlike first game, which was ported by Micronix, Capcom did 1943 themselves. Naturally, they changed stuff around a bit. So, they added RPG elements to a shoot-em-up. Well, why not? Occasionally, special items will be found that let you sort of add additional points to those attributes. So you sort of level up your plane as the game progresses. You increase your attack power, life bar, and so on. Every level has you fighting waves and waves of airplanes. Red airplanes drop power-ups, and these are actually shot sort of Twin Bee style. They will start off as like a partial life bar refill, and then shooting them will cause them to change to power-ups for weapons or better life bar refills. I guess the strategy here is sort of balanced with picking up power-ups and health refills. If it's at all possible, you want to have a special weapon when you reach the boss, and plenty of health. Now here's a typical boss, it's a large warship. The object here is to knock out all the guns and cannons, and you slowly inch forward while fighting a boss. One problem, sometimes you'll encounter there is barely enough room to squeeze in below a gun if it's near the bottom of the screen. When this happens, it's really easy to get hit when the gun fires, almost impossible to get out of the way in time. So once the boss is defeated, you get some additional health points. These are added on to your existing health points, thus raising your total health. Your total health will tend to increase as the game progresses. So while 1943 is pretty slick, there are some issues modern shooter fans might have. First of all, there are quite a few levels, 24, and they can get pretty repetitive because there's a very limited number of enemies, and the bosses actually repeat themselves quite a bit. Thank God there is a password system. You get a password every time you die, so you really can finish the game with enough perseverance. But the whole business of taking special weapons that have a timer on them, and your health slowly ticking down as well, is pretty hateful. There's often not a power-up close to the boss, so sometimes you end up having to enter a boss fight with no special weapon and low health. And I hate it when there's like a few moments of like nothing happening, like when you're approaching a boss and you sort of fly over some empty water and you can see your various timers like running down. You're all, come on, hurry up, to the boss. I've only got 10 seconds left on a three-way shot. And of course, it's not always easy to get the item that you're looking for when you get a power-up. This is especially true on the later levels, where there are so many enemies on screen, it makes it virtually impossible to hit the power-up, much less hit it the correct number of times to get the item that you want. The last levels have these multiple bosses, and they're all repeats of earlier bosses. These guys can get pretty easy with the correct weapon, but darned hard without it. Like this guy right here, for example. If you don't have this this three-way shot, he's pretty tough, because you have to dodge bullets while hitting the wings. And this guy is basically a more difficult version of the same thing. Now the last level ends with a whole bunch of battleships. and I ended up not finishing it. The problem was not being able to collect the power-ups during the regular part of the level, so I basically ran out of health and weapons towards the end. So 1943, it's a good, if not great, game. Nowadays, we probably expect a bit more variety out of our shoot-em-ups. Wow, now we're getting into some sketchy stuff. Fire Rock from System SACOM. Remember Firebam from HAL a few episodes ago? Well, this is worse than that. Specifically, this is Mark Flint Presents Fire Rock. Okay, now who the hell is Mark Flint? He was a programmer at System SACOM who is considered, quote, legendary, unquote, by some folks in the Japanese video game field. This title screen would certainly indicate some great programming skills if this were an Atari 2600 game. This was published by Yuse, who apparently are quite committed to putting out low-quality games. So Mark Flint was a guy from Texas who ended up working for some Japanese software companies. He seems pretty well known for a 1986 PC-98 game called Highway Star. I suppose this seems pretty impressive for a 3D game in 1986. Not sure exactly why his name gets featured so predominantly in the System SACOM games. I guess they really like the guy. Maybe the one game we might know in the US that Mark Flint was attached to is Mansion of Hidden Souls. Horrible voice acting coming up in 3, 2, 1.
Where am I?
Yeah, great.
There was no
it's a first-person mist-like adventure game. It was oddly enough re-released for the Saturn by Sega. Again, I guess it looks pretty decent for the era. Okay, so back to Fire Rock. Well, this looks like your average everyday third-person side-view action platformer type game, but with a twist. It involves a lot of climbing up walls, and the controls are awkward, to put it kindly. Awkward in this case is a euphemism for they goddamn suck. And when you first try this game, you're going to end up in that pool of lava, probably more than once. And as soon as you start touching lava, you end up bouncing around like a spaz and can't jump out. Now you can jump and land on the walls, and pressing A caused you to climb up, but it seems impossible to actually land on top of the platform. And your weapon doesn't seem to like be able to break holes in the walls, so what do? The game just started and already I'm stuck. Well, here's the trick. To climb a wall, you need to walk up or jump to it and then press the D-pad to the left or the right, towards the wall. You gotta glue down your finger on that D-pad. Do not decrease pressure on the D-pad for even the tiniest bit. And you slowly hit the A button over and over again if you want to go up, B if you're going down. Very carefully make your way to the top, then climb over the top of the edge. If you get a chance, grab that blue heart for invincibility and kill the purple blob thing. Ah, there we go. Now hopefully you have mastered the wall climbing mechanic because you're going to be constantly using it. Yeah, almost every single ledge is too high to jump on. To get around requires constant wall climbing, and letting your finger relax for even a moment will always result in you falling into a conveniently placed lava pit. So, have fun. Now, by the way, there is a cheat that prevents you from taking damage. You turn on the game and hold down A and B together. Let the title screen text load up 16 times, and then hit start. But even with that on, Fire Rock is still a big pain in the ass. Enemies attack you while climbing walls, and if there's a way to shoot while on a wall, I certainly could not find it. Some areas are really hard to reach, and when you jump and try to latch onto a wall, sometimes you hang on and sometimes you fall. Alright, so this is definitely not the worst game we've seen for the FDS, and I kinda like the music, but damn, that wall climbing gets real old fast, so not cool, Mr. Mark Flint. We're going to take a little break from the Famicom and go back to adventure games. It's time for the second and final part of our history of adventure games. Last time we covered from the birth of the genre in the US, from the early text games like Colossal Cave, up to Sierra's domination in the late 80s. And in Japan, we saw the clunky text parsers in old PC-88 games give way to more streamlined menus in Portopia and the minigames that followed in its wake. As mentioned last time, the Sierra Graphic Adventure games used a standard text parser to make your character interact with the world, but this was beginning to change. In 1984, Apple released the Macintosh computer, which integrated a mouse into its input scheme. Game developers were very quick to make good use of the mouse, and in 1984, an adventure game called Enchanted Scepters was released by a little software company called Silicon Beach Software. So rather than typing text, you use the mouse to make words from the command menus along the top. Much like the menus in Japanese adventure games, this eliminated the need to memorize a game's vocabulary and syntax. Next year, a far more successful game was released by ICOM Simulations. Deja Vu let you use the mouse to click on objects or scenery, drag and drop items to and from your inventory, select actions from a menu, and so on. The premise was not too original. You play as a hard-boiled detective with amnesia, but the point-and-click mechanic opened up huge possibilities for the genre. ICOM followed up Deja Vu with two more point-and-click adventure games, the spooky The Uninvited, and the dungeon-crawling Shadowgate. All three, of course, were later ported to other computers and even the NES. ICOM borrowed the dry, morbid sense of humor found in Sierra's games. They also borrowed frequent and surprising deaths. Doing anything, even something as harmless as opening a door or picking up an object, can suddenly kill. Now, this tradition goes way back in adventure gaming, but it actually soon came to an end. Lucas Games, the game development branch of Lucasfilm, later known as LucasArts, released Maniac Mansion for the Commodore 64. It altered the course of adventure games in several ways. First of all, it dropped the text parser and instead used a point-and-click system to move your character and to build sentences. Rather than typing pick up the faucet, you simply clicked on pick up in the menu and then the item you wish to grab. The what is query would help you identify important objects as opposed to mere background detail. Maniac Mansion was also one of the first to insert cutscenes, and that actually sort of furthered the plot. Also, there are multiple ways to complete the game, based on which characters you picked at the very beginning. And perhaps most importantly, deaths were much more logical, and there were no situations where the game became unwinnable because of a wrong decision earlier in the game. If you missed an item, you could always go back and get it or find another solution. Maniac Mansion also introduced LucasArts' trademark goofy sense of humor. One classic moment is when you microwave Ed's pet hamster and then give it back to him. This will cause your death, but really, you had it coming. LucasArts' breaking into the adventure game scene ushered what I think we'd probably want to call the golden age of adventure games. Advances in graphics and sound technology and home computers meant games suddenly started looking and sounding a lot better. Everything kind of came together in 1990's Secret of Monkey Island, which was a product of a veritable murderer's row of game designers, Tim Schafer, Ron Gilbert, and Dave Grossman. By this time, LucasArts had actually done away with in-game death entirely. With enough perseverance, you could finish the game. Unlike, say, Japanese dating sims, which we'll see a little later, there is no way to lose by selecting a wrong dialogue choice. Thus, you could spend less time worrying about screwing up, and more time experimenting and having fun. So it was an adventure game that rewarded curiosity instead of punishing it. What a great concept! By the early 90s, high-quality adventure games were coming out of the woodwork. Sierra had modernized its formula a bit, with recent releases featuring streamlined controls and VGA artwork, as well as mouse input. Lots of little details made the in-game worlds more interactive. For example, in Space Quest IV, released in 1991, you could taste or smell items, often for very humorous effect. Of course, it was still very easy to die. Now about this time, new aesthetic possibilities were opening up. LucasArts' Day of the Tentacle, a 1993 sequel to Maniac Mansion, used an art style inspired by old Tex Avery cartoons, and threw in like a crazy time-traveling plot. Memorable characters, puzzles that actually make sense, and a funny script. This is really one of the high points of adventure gaming. A lot of these early adventure games or games around this time had really bad voice acting, but that's definitely not the case here. I mean, everything is really top-notch. As you might notice, it uses a very similar interface there to Maniac Mansion. LucasArts kept this up for several years, releasing just one great game after another. In fact, there seemed to be some sort of arms race in the mid-90s to see who could come up with the most beautiful-looking adventure game. One contender, Revolution Software's Broken Sword, a European conspiracy-themed mystery game, with some of the best-looking 2D graphics ever. Not to mention the very easy-to-use intuitive controls, and also, once again, great voice acting, everything you could want.
Have you met the clown before?
It's a long story.
That's how you choose your subject for dialogue. There are those little icons along the lower left.
You speak very good English for a French girl.
Thanks.
Larry Laffer?
Welcome aboard the PMS
Bounty. About this time, even Sierra was getting bleeding edge, with later entries in old series such as King's Quest and Leadersuit Larry being among some of the best-looking games out there. By this point, the Larry games had abandoned the frequent death thing. Here, you can take as much time as you want escaping the flames without dying. Another nice touch? A map of the world. Also, you'll find crazy options like Lick. There's also a weird Where's Waldo parody, and once again, a whole lot of excellent voice work.
That wasn't worth it.
Apparently, there are so many, like, objects in these games you can, like, click on and get, like, weird or interesting humor subscriptions. I mean, it's not like it's only items that actually have a use. You can pick up or describe or look at all kinds of crazy things. So, traditional 2D adventure games are doing pretty well, especially from about 94 to 95, but things were changing. One of the first signs came in 1991 when Infocom, the guys behind the MacVenture games, released Sherlock Holmes Consulting Detective for computers and the relatively new TurboGrafx-16 CD add-on. The game demonstrated a relatively new technology. Full-motion video, clips of filmed actors, and recorded voices took the place of the usual dialogue windows and sprites.
What did you learn, Watson?
Not a thing, Holmes.
You learned of course, the full motion video was actually quite crude at this point due to the heavy compression used in these consoles. And the game was not too successful, but 2 years later, another CD-ROM game took the world by storm.
I realized the moment I fell into the fissure.
Yep, I'm sure you know this one. Myst from Cyan World became the so-called killer app of the still new CD-ROM format. In many ways, Myst was radically different from most other adventure games. It was first person, lacked dialogue. The only text was that found inside the occasional book that you picked up. There was really no inventories to speak of. It was virtually plotless. You wandered around a mostly empty island, solving puzzles on how to operate weird pieces of machinery. Yet the beautiful 3D graphics, clever use of full motion video, and sound design made it a huge smash hit. The biggest selling computer game up to that point, moving about 6 million units. Here we see some of the very clever use of the limited full motion video that was available at that time. This was amazingly impressive when it first came out, believe it or not. And also more big selling CD-ROM games followed, including Virgin Interactive's The Seventh Guest. In 1995, Sierra decided to go into the exciting world of FMV and released a game from Roberta Williams called Phantasmagoria. I love this double waking up from a dream sequence here. Probably surprised everyone the first time they saw it. Now, while structured pretty much like in a standard adventure game, sprites were replaced with digitized actors on a computer-generated background. One problem with many early full-motion video games, the acting. While Phantasmagoria features a few seasoned actors, the most well-known being 1960s sexpot Stella Stevens, some of the performances were of like a grade Z movie quality. Now, the game produced tons of controversy over its adults-only content, a bit of sex and a lot of gore. Regardless, it was Sierra's biggest selling adventure game, and they followed up with more FMV games. Here we see perhaps the two most problematic actors in terms of overacting here.
What do you say, huh? We'll work for nothing.
But both Myst and Phantasmagoria were both attempts to sort of draw non-gamers into the whole adventure game field, by offering them games that were perhaps a bit easier or had some sort of sensationalistic qualities to them. Sierra's second full-motion video game was Gabriel Knight, The Beast Within. This was the second in the conspiracy-themed Gabriel Knight series, and probably had better integration of live actors and computer-generated content. In this case, photographic backgrounds were used. And for the most part, the voice acting tends to be a little better. Gabriel Knight himself, with his sort of prosaic descriptions and southern drawl, comes up as having a sort of bit more character than the protagonist of Phantasmagoria.
This bag contains cement. Chanel.
The game also uses a rather simple drop-and-drag system for moving around objects, and even lets you visit various real-world locations. We can go to the Marienplatz here. The game utilizes photographs of the actual Marienplatz, and you can even see such things as the famous Glockenspiel. Countless excellent games hit the shelves around this time. Far too many to list here. One very unique game was the Neverhood Chronicles, or just the Neverhood, designed by some of the creators behind the Earthworm Jim games. Rather than using sprites or digitized actors, it used claymation, which is actually a pretty ingenious idea. There is a certain Myst influence here, what with its silent hero and alien, almost empty world, but it feels unlike any other game of its time. This kind of reminds me of like the moving from island to island moments in Riven, for example. The sequels, sadly, were not adventure games, rather other genres. Now, the entire adventure game genre was very healthy until about 1997, suddenly it began dying. New adventure games used expensive computer-generated graphics, voicing acting, and 3D environments. LucasArts released a couple of last great adventure games, such as Grim Fandango in 1998. Amazingly high production values make the game a classic, and it is considered by some to be the last great game of the genre. Which brings up a point. By this time, the adventure gaming fan community had split in two. During the times of games such as Day of the Tentacle, the only room for debate was whether the newest LucasArts first hero game was merely brilliant or the greatest game of all time. Now fans no longer agreed on the merits of Myst or Phantasmagoria or the last games in the Gabriel Knight or King's Quest series. Some love them, others absolutely hated them. Either way, big budget adventure games pretty much ceased to exist. The last nail in the coffin came in 2004 when the long in development ZeniMax sequel was officially cancelled by LucasArts. It looks like Don's rigged his computer. Still, the genre continued to plug along at the hands of independent or European developers. Funcom's The Longest Journey from 1999 was one of the more well-known traditional adventure games, featuring nice production values, though it is sort of hampered by some rather ugly CG characters. So on through the 2000s, the adventure game lived on because fans, critics, and smaller companies like Funcom, the Adventure Company, or Microids still believe in the genre. This game also suffered from some kind of not particularly good voice acting.
It's Monkey Boy!
Still, it's a very good-looking game and rather interesting. Whether or not you'll enjoy it, I mean, it definitely does not have quite the same fun appeal of something like, you know, the old Sam & Max or Monkey Island games.
It's at one the same spot almost every day.
Again, some very beautiful backgrounds here. And all the characters are, of course, full 3D. Microids became one of the major developers for the genre in the 2000s. Here is Siberia from 2002. Again, very nice graphics, an easy-to-use interface, and decent if not spectacular music. Use that key to grab it from the inventory, drag it and drop it on the object, and there you go. Now the game has many fans, and it got pretty good reviews, but it seems in some ways to me to be sort of like a big, beautiful, but completely empty world.
No need to go down there.
Yeah, you'll be hearing that a lot in this game. I mean, why make all these houses and doors clickable if you can never enter them? It also suffers from pixel hunting syndrome, and some folks feel the puzzles are too easy. Often it's just sort of like search all around until you find the key that opens up the door to the puzzle or something like that. And people complain about nowadays console games having graphics that are all gray and brown. Same thing goes for this as well. Well, in the last couple years, there has been a bit of a comeback in the genre, perhaps due to several LucasArts designers forming Telltale Games and reviving Sam & Max and Monkey Island, as well as sort of high-profile European titles like Machinarium. But still, in the West, while the adventure games genre might not be completely dead, it's certainly relatively quiet. The same can definitely not be said for Japan, however. So in Japan, things turned out quite a bit differently. We've seen adventure games proliferate on the Famicom and Japanese computers, but things begin to change with the release of the PC Engine CD add-on. The first adventure game on that system was Cobra, Kokuryu no Densetsu from Hudson, based on a manga and anime of the same name. Look at these impressive graphics here. Now while this isn't really too much different than what we've seen before gameplay-wise, it's a pretty big leap over the Famicom games in terms of graphics and CD sound that actual human speech could be included. Pretty impressive. Incidentally, this was popular enough to warrant a sequel, which was released in the US under the name Space Adventure Cobra, The Legendary Bandit, on the Sega CD. Now, developers had to do something with all that extra space on a CD, so long animated intros became popular. Ooh, this is pretty gory. These were sort of more elaborate versions of the intros seen in other Famicom Adventure games. This is Nishimura Kirotaro from Naxosoft in 1990. Sort of a typical murder mystery adventure game, just like what we've been seeing, only sort of bumped up to the next generation. Eventually, the PC Engine became home to lots of pretty girl games, sometimes in the form of Mahjong games or RPGs, but the most successful in the long run was Tokimeki Memorial. Konami borrowed the general idea of a dating sim, not to mention the title, from Nintendo's Nakayama Miho game. But unlike a lot of similar games, this really was a sort of sim. That is, you like sort of build up stats and operate strategically to cultivate a relationship with a girl. It's sort of like Harvest Moon, but with romance instead of farming.
Sayonara.
Now on the other end of the spectrum, we have Koei's Angelique, first released a few months after Tokimeki Memorial by Koei for the Super Famicom. Angelique is an otome game, meaning a dating sim for girls. Here the object is to win the heart of one of several young princes, some of whom are rather androgynous looking. Just like Tokimeki, there is much more gameplay than later so-called dating sims. There's also a very long tradition of releasing and re-releasing these games. For example, Angelique was ported to the Saturn and PlayStation with these anime cutscenes and some voice acting all sort of added on to the beginning there. And the game itself has occasional bits of voice acting as well. Other than that, it's pretty much the same game. Now, the libraries of the PC Engine and Saturn are cluttered with dating sims, and various games involving pictures of cute anime-style girls. I think what kept those two platforms alive in Japan for so long was these types of games. After the PC Engine, NEC's next console was the ill-fated PC FX, which is by far the most Japanese game console ever released. I think its library consisted entirely of RPGs, adventure games, and dating sims, and every single game features like a big-eyed anime chick on the box art. This one, Welcome to Pia Carrot, is one of the few PC FX games to be fan-translated into English. It's a Tokimeki-style dating sim with adult content, meaning that if you did all the right things when romancing the girl, at the very end you would get to sleep with her. Usually the adult was reserved for non-Nintendo consoles, though the really dirty stuff would actually be on the computer versions only sometimes. That said, it seems a little odd that Pia Carrot 2 was released on the Game Boy Color. And of course, you can definitely see the influence in later games like Sakura Taisen or Persona 3 or 4. However, these old games like Pia Carrot can be a little opaque at times. I mean, you have to make exactly the right choices in order to win the girl, and it's really not clear when you're playing the game what those choices are. I'm sure this was to increase the shelf life of the game, you had to sort of play them over and over again experimenting. One of the more well-known adventure games of this era, despite never having been released outside of Japan, is Hideo Kojima's Police Knots, first released in 1994 on the PC-98. This is the spruced-up PlayStation port from 2 years later. Now, thanks to the superb fan translation, the PlayStation game can now be enjoyed by folks in the English-speaking world. This features pretty high-quality animated cutscenes and a large amount of voice work, so it's definitely on the more high end of the gaming scale. The gameplay resembles Western adventure games, using a point-and-click system to look at items, move around, and talk to folks. There are even some shooting sequences, but these are not really implemented that well. And like many of Kojima's games, its main emphasis is on telling a story, so Western gamers might find it a bit too linear and straightforward for their tastes. While all of this was going on, Japanese adventure games were undergoing a bit of a change. Koichi Nakamura's Chunsoft began publishing games themselves, as opposed to developing titles for Enix, starting with Otogariso. This was a Super Famicom game in 1992. Nakamura had co-designed the Famicom Portopia with Yuji Horii. Otogariso was also a mystery adventure game, but with a big difference. The entire game interface and all the commands such as look, talk, etc. have been removed. The gameplay has been greatly streamlined, and the amount of text increased. Occasionally you'll be presented with several options to choose from. The player uses the D-pad and the button on the right to pick the option he wants to choose. Otogariso is really a choose-your-own-adventure novel in video game form, with an emphasis on using the graphics and sound sort of suck the player into the game's world. Perhaps that's why Chunsoft called it a sound novel. They followed up with a couple other games for the Famicom, and then the big one, Machi, for the Saturn in 1998. Machi is a very slick and high-budget-looking game. It uses still photographs and full-motion video, but it all looks much more pleasing to the eye than, say, Gabriel Knight, The Beast Within. The game concerns a group of individuals in the Shibuya district whose lives interlock in various ways. Now, the game was quite successful in Japan, and as you might recall from a few episodes ago, came in number 5 in the 2006 Famitsu Reader's Poll of the greatest video games of all time. A long-awaited spiritual sequel, 428, was released for the Wii in 2008, and immediately received a perfect score in Famitsu, and various multimedia spin-offs have occurred. Alright, now let's move on to seedier territory. Adult games have been around in Japan as long as personal computers have, and there were plenty of adult-themed adventure games, RPGs, mahjong games, and so on in the 1980s and early 90s. But the whole adult visual novel genre was popularized by a series of games from a company called Leaf, starting with Shizuku, which means drop, or maybe drip, in 1996. For whatever reason, this format, massive amounts of text coupled with an occasional A button or B button decision, greatly appealed to Japanese gamers, and just as the adventure game was dying in the West, it exploded in Japan. Tons of visual novels began to appear in the mid to late 90s. Here's one of the very first of a US release, Critical Point, from 1998 by Sweet Basil. All of these games are strikingly similar. The viewpoint's in first person, you see a series of static backgrounds, in front of which various characters appear, you converse with the characters, sometimes you're required to make a decision or an action or dialogue choice. But just like those fish who live at the bottom of the oceans, whose eyesight has atrophied over many generations, the gameplay of visual novels has sort of withered away to merely pressing the enter button a bunch of times. There's always some sort of plot to make your way through, but in the adult visual novels, your sub-goals usually involve bedding one or more women in the game, distinguished by their prefabricated personality types and their wacky hair colors. But since then, visual novels remain far and away the most popular computer game genre in Japan, and I suspect a rather large chunk of those are adult games. The relatively low development costs make it easier for independent developers to crank these things out. Some big hit titles, in fact, were created using pre-existing visual novel creator software engines. Canon from 1999. Moving along, we have Canon, one of the most popular visual novels of the era, eventually ported to the Dreamcast, PS2, and PSP, with spin-off manga and anime as well. So adult adventure games are quite mainstream in Japan. This one involves a protagonist with amnesia and throws in various supernatural elements. Once again, you attempt to woo a girl by picking the correct options, which takes you down sort of the right story path. Tsukihima from Type Moon was another hugely popular visual novel. You might have heard of its spin-off fighting game, Melty Blood. Yeah, that's what it's called. Again, a cute girls plus supernatural theme. And once again, it's mostly just walls and walls of text with the occasional decision that needs to be made. The ending that you get will depend on the decisions that you made throughout the game. There's always like several good endings and several bad endings in these things. There's often like a perfect ending or something like that. We have to make every single decision correctly. And again, whether or not a decision is correct or incorrect, it's sort of arbitrary at times. Now, at this point in time, the Japanese visual novel scene was incredibly strong. To give you an idea of just how strong, checking on the Visual Novel Database website, they list around 60 titles released last month, August 2010. So unlike the West, the adventure game genre is very strong, just in a form that most Western gamers wouldn't really accept as an adventure game. To give you an idea, I looked up a walkthrough of Tsukihima, and there's only about 35 interactive decisions that you make in the entire game. And often in the games that are pure sex games, there's even fewer decisions than those, and the only real objective is to go through the path of the game correctly in order to like have sex with the correct girls or all the girls. So some of these, you know, barely even resemble what we would actually call video games, which is why I guess they call them visual novels in Japan. Well, that pretty much wraps it up. Now it's time to go back to the Famicom games. Alright, Konami! Yay! What wonderful things does Konami have for us this time? First, geez, that is one seriously ugly title screen. Now, we've seen Konami hop on the RPG train some time ago with Esper Dream. Now it's adventure game time. Riza no Yosei Densetsu, Riza Tachibana, or Riza's Fairy Tale. Riza Tachibana being one of those so-called idols. Just like Nakayama Miho, this game was apparently inspired by the success of the Nakayama Miho Tokimeki High School game. I can hardly wait. Unlike the Nintendo game, however, this isn't really a dating sim. As the name implies, it's a fairy tale themed adventure game. Your goal is to save the world, not get laid. Now, there was a bit of a media campaign around this game. Riza was, I guess, pretty popular at the time, had a few albums out, and even released a tie-in single for the game. Let's give it a listen. Check out these moves. Yes, this woman is an incredibly talented dancer, a modern-day Isadora Duncan, if you will. Apparently the song and dance contain hints for the game itself. So anyway, you find Riza lying unconscious, and then you have your way with her. No, actually, no, it's not that kind of game. You wake her up, and she enlists your aid in saving the frickin' fairy tale world from an evil witch who wants to spread darkness over the world, and you need to find the magic symbols of blah blah blah. Why do these games always involve finding some sort of magic orb or crystal or triforce or something silly like that? She's wearing a crown here for some reason or another. Oh yeah, and that's the witch. Now, once you actually make your way to the fairy tale world, the game becomes a standard menu-based adventure game. Except for one unusual feature, it doesn't utilize the typical first-person viewpoint found in most games like this. The camera, if you will, is a bit further back, so you can see both you and Risa at all times. It's also like a third-person adventure game. So I guess in some ways it's not completely unoriginal. For the most part, though, it seems pretty much like Princess Tomato. You go in, look at stuff, talk to people multiple times, wait for new areas to open up, and then use the move option to go there. Now, the little girl's name seems to be the Match Girl, though this chapter actually involves a rat living in a basement, I think, so it's sort of based on the story of the little Match Girl. Later chapters are based on Snow White, Alice in Wonderland, and Cinderella stories. Something else that's ripped directly from the Nakayama Miho game, there are telephone numbers where you can get hints and that sort of thing. Obviously, these numbers, I'm sure, stopped functioning many years ago. Well, sorry to disappoint all you Konami fans. If it's any consolation, Blades of Steel will be turning up next episode. Namco makes a surprise appearance here with Yokai Dochuki. or what, as it was known in English, Shadowland, though a literal translation would be Yokai Travel Journal. Yokai being those weird Japanese ghost demon things that pop up in numerous video games like Gegege no Kitaro. Now this should look familiar because it's the third time we've seen it. First popped up in the 1987 arcade roundup, then again in Cron Turbo Episode 1, when a port for the PC Engine, courtesy of Toza, came out in February of 1988. It was in fact the first third-party game released for the PC Engine. Now, 5 months later, Famicom owners finally get a chance to play the game. This was ported by Now Production, the guys behind Namco's Jikku Yuten Debias, that horrible RPG from 1987, though later they would go on to more reputable stuff, including, surprisingly, Katamari Damacy. While this is clearly a lot uglier than the PC Engine arcade game, but it is a bit more faithful to the original than the PC Engine version, though a new aspect has been added that wasn't in the other two versions, your pious meter, which directly affects whether you go to heaven or hell at the end of the game. You might be thinking, I sort of remember something similar in another game from a while back. Oh yeah, that was Spelunker 2, that wacky Japan-only sequel to Spelunker. It had a toku meter, toku meaning virtue. If it got too low, you went to hell. And guess who developed Spelunker 2? I wonder why it was Now Production. I guess that's their thing. Another difference is during boss battles, you will need to have a scroll to call on the spirit to fight for you. Otherwise, you have to fight the demon yourself. You pick up these scrolls here and there. Other than that, there's not that much notable about the Famicom Yokai Dochuki, beyond what's already been said in Cron Turbo. I guess play that version instead, or heck, play the arcade game. Hey, it's RPG time from Kemco, though it's not really clear who developed this game. I sense ninjas will be involved. Sonata Juyushi, which normally is translated into English as Sonata 10 Braves. Now, what are the Sonata 10 Braves, you ask? Well, Sonata Masayuki was one of the major Sengoku-era daimyo. His son, Sonata Yukimura, became quite well known for his military exploits. This is a statue of him. The Sonatas were aligned against Ieyasu Tokugawa. Legend has it that there were 10 warriors, or ninjas, who acted as Yukimura's retainers, the most famous of which was Sarutobi Sasuke, one of the major legendary ninja dudes. He's sometimes depicted as a wild, monkey-like kid, like in this animated film about him. Naturally, the Sonatas and Sasuke has turned up in various video games, mangas, and so on. Now your first thoughts are probably, hey, looks like a Dragon Warrior clone. And you're right, this borrows heavily from the look of the Dragon Warrior games, but underneath the hood, it's actually quite a bit different. Whereas Dragon Quest II had you sort of run around and find two other party members, here you need to find all 10 Braves. So we'll head on out to the town, you'll find the typical RPG village stuff. And in true Dragon Quest style, among the other various shops, there's a place to gamble. This is one of those games where you bet on whether the dice will turn up odd or even, and it's pure luck, of course. But if you want to perform some save state abuse, then you can make some tall cash. You'll need to buy weapons and food. Now things work a bit differently here than in most RPGs. The options on your character menu are a little odd. Aside from the usual talk and whatnot, you have the option to issue commands to other members of your party, and to check your war provisions, which seems to consist of food and weapons. Now I've just found the first Brave here. This is Sasuke, I believe. Generally, you will have to perform some kind of task before they'll join you. Different party members will require different weapons, by the way. Sonata himself uses swords, I believe the ninjas use like throwing stars or bombs or whatnot. Now in combat, each turn will give you the option to select a party member. Battles are fought one-on-one, since there's only ever one enemy at a time. So you can choose a party member to fight the first round, and then in the second round you can choose a different one if you prefer. The various Braves will often come in handy in other situations as well. Here, a guarded wooden gate blocks this mountain pass. One guy is able to set off bombs, so select him from the main menu, and he'll bomb and blow up the gate for you. And when encountering enemies, there's another option other than run or fight. There's talk. This allows you to negotiate with enemies. Now, as far as I can tell, enemies or some of the enemy's army might join you in exchange for weapons or food, I believe. I don't really see anything like a level, per se, on your characters. Their strength seems to be based on the size of their army. Here, for example, Sonata has 32 men in his army. Now, this all sounds very interesting, but is it actually a good game? Well, Kemco's track record isn't really too hot. I've noticed there aren't a whole lot of enemy types. As the game progresses, you sort of keep getting more of the same enemy types, they just have more troops. But you do get these rather weird little guys in day-glow purple suits with guns who turn up from time to time. All in all, it appears to be a rather strange RPG that's sort of fallen through the cracks. Last game of June, and it's, oh geez, Kyokyoku Harikiri Stadium from Taito, developed by, who knows? But every other single Taito original game so far has been a product of Tozei or some of the other low-end contract developers. This has got to be from one of those guys. It's a cute little title sequence, however. Guy gets crushed by a giant baseball. That represents how you feel when you play the game. By the way, the title means something like Ultimate Excitement Stadium. Harikiri means enthusiasm or excitement, not to be confused with Harakiri meaning suicide via self-disembowelment. I got the two words mixed up at first. And you know, I'm getting pretty sick and tired of all these Family Stadium clones we've been seeing. We just had one last episode, Major League Baseball. At this point, I'd be perfectly happy if I never saw another 8-bit baseball game as long as I lived. This is just like all the others, more or less. The controls work the same way as every other such game. When batting while playing against the CPU, you'll get annoyed by the fact that the CPU will catch every single fly ball without fail. One of its players was to walk to exactly where the ball is going to land. When you're fielding, however, it's difficult to tell exactly where the ball is going or really how high it is at any given time. You have to watch the shadow, but it's difficult to say if the ball's like right above your head or just going to sail right over you. Naturally, when you're pitching, the CPU will hit almost every single pitch. Getting strikes is pretty difficult. And of course, the usual complaints apply. You can't see your outfielders until the ball actually reaches the outfield, making it very difficult to get them into position. Really, this game is instantly forgettable. And in fact, I'm already getting it kind of confused with Major League Baseball from last episode. I'd actually skip both this game and that game if I were you. July 12th marks a special day, I'll tell you why in just a sec. Let's load this thing up, and it is Akara Senki Raijin, published by Square's DOG label, and developed by Microcabin. And yes, this is all there is in terms of an intro, combat action game. At least your mech guy looks badass.
Well, the joke's on you, I'm afraid.
Like all FDS games, there are usually some serious loading screens. Okay, so the game starts, and what do? You start by going up, but you can't go up, can't go to the side, or really anywhere. Eventually you'll start pushing some random buttons, and you'll find the select button turns you into a spaceship. Great! So Akara Senki Raijin is a shoot-'em-up. Wonderful, right? Oh, just you wait. First of all, you notice the enemy ships are way faster and more maneuverable than you, and they seem to take off in multiple hits to kill. And you can only have 3 bullets on the screen at once. If you try to rapid fire, you'll find the bullets only reach about like maybe 1/3 of the length of the screen. Now seriously, you'd think you'd want to unleash as many bullets as possible in order to take out waves of these guys, but nope, 3 bullets. Feels like you're playing Zanuck with Space Invaders weapons. When a wave of enemies comes at you, if you don't get out of the way, you're probably going to get hit. If you're close enough to an enemy to shoot them, there's a good chance they will also shoot you. You have a special weapon fired with the B button, but it's more comparable to like a regular shoot-'em-up weapon, but you can only fire it like 20 times until you find refills. And before too long, you'll reach this dead end. You take damage if you don't stop by turning back into a robot. If you keep going, you'll actually hit the wall and take some damage. Then those guys you saw a moment ago decide to come out and kick your ass. not really a fair fight because they always shoot directly at you and at an angle at the same time. Everyone totally outguns you in this game. So at this point, what do you do? Well, who knows, eventually if you turn around and head back, you might find certain screens that you can land on. One, midway through the level, has paths leading to the left and the right, so you can head down these and explore. Well, let me get back to why July 12th was a special day. DOG released two games that day, this and Moonball Magic, which were the last two games ever for the label. Yep, Square dropped the whole DOG business and released all future games in cartridge form. It's been said that these two games were only released in the Famicom Disk Writer format. They were never released as regular retail packages, you know, where you bought a blank disc and had the program written onto it. That seems possible, but I did find some cover art for the game, so it's hard to say. Now, if the name Microcabin sounds familiar, it's because they did a lot of those games in the History of the Adventure Games segment from last episode. They did like tons of PC-88 and PC-98 games. This is the only Famicom game they've been attached to, though they are still around today. Perhaps their most well-known series is Princess Maker. Well, back to the game. You can wander around and find some items. What do they do? How do you leave the level? I have no idea. None of the items I found seemed useful in removing that barrier on the last screen. The whole thing seems more like a low-rent version of Guardian Legend. However the rest of this game turns out, the shooting sequences are so poorly executed nothing can really save this. When it comes to shoot 'em up, Square would eventually redeem themselves with a game called Einhander, but obviously that's not until many years later. Here's the other game from DOG. Hey, my buddy Mark Flint! Moonball Magic. It's weird that System Sacom developed two Mark Flint games for two different publishers. They both have the same intro screen and everything. Well, I guess this is the demo here. Hey, wait a second. I lost a life? Is this the game? The flippers are moving when I hit the buttons. Am I already playing? So before I was even aware the game started, I've already lost? Huh, let's try this again. What's going on here? Oh, I see. This is the title sequence. Need to get the ball in the slot in order to start the game. Alright, Mark Flint, you got me. Mark Flint 1, Dr. Sparkle 0. But this is not yet over. I'll admit, it's a clever idea. So, Moonball Magic is a pinball game, because the moon is silver and round, just like pinball. This thing actually seems to go on and on. Finally, here we go, now the game itself will actually start. Now, any points that you earned during that intro will actually carry over. Now, what drives me crazy is the music on the first level. What is it? It sounds like J.S. Bach or something, but I just can't quite seem to place it. I think all the music is for this game is being been borrowed from classical pieces. Now, unlike Nintendo's old pinball game, this one has multiple levels, 11 to be precise. In order to move on to the next level, you have to get the ball in a particular slot. It's that one kind of up at the very top in the center there. Not that difficult at first, but really starts getting rough around level 3. But you know, unlike some pinball games, there's actually quite a bit of variety. I mean, it's not just one screen, there's a lot of different levels, like I said, 11, and they're all completely different. Now this, as I mentioned, is in fact the last game on the DOG label. Can't say I'll miss it, because 99% of their stuff was crap. Most DOG games were apparently very unsuccessful, supposedly so much so that it drove Square to the edge of bankruptcy, as the old story goes. Now, unlike Akara's Hinky Raijin, I couldn't find a cover to this game, so I assume this one really was only available for the Disc Rider. Either way, I guess it's sort of a rather inglorious end to DOG. Thank you. BPS. Sure, it sounds like an acronym for some unpleasant medical condition, but it really stands for Bulletproof Software. Last game today is Super Black Onyx. BPS, as you may recall, is the brainchild of Hank Rogers, seen here posing in front of the Super Black Onyx cover art by Roger Dean, apparently. And this game is a highly modified port of Bulletproof Software's first game, Black Onyx, originally released on the PC-88 way back in 1984. In David Sheff's book Game Over, he gives the following story about Black Onyx. Hank's family had moved to Japan in the late 70s, and Hank decided to go into the software business. So he whipped up Black Onyx and published it himself, but no one would buy it because the Japanese had no idea what an RPG was. Thus he took copies to some software magazine, explained the whole concept of RPGs, and soon enough everyone there was hooked. The magazine published a glowing review, Black Onyx was a huge hit, and basically started the Japanese obsession with RPGs. Supposedly this happened in 1980. I don't know about that date, couldn't find any record of this coming out on an older computer. The story is kind of short on details, the magazine is not actually named. Did it happen? Who knows. So anyway, the original Black Onyx was pretty much a standard Wizardry Ultimate type RPG that takes advantage of the PC-88's graphical power. It was sort of odd. You can customize your character's hair and clothing, but nothing else. There's not even any magic in the game. Now, for Super Black Onyx, choose your characters from several prefabricated selections. Hero, Monk, Mage. Those are the three classes. Well, there's an awful lot of characters there. Why are there so many? And they all have the same stats. 10 Dexterity and 12 Strength. Geez, how many are there of these guys? Well, incredibly, there are around 45 or so choices for your starting characters. And then several times in the game, you encounter tons of more potential party members. It puts Widokin to shame. But the really only difference between these guys is the names. So, I don't know, crazy, why didn't just let you choose a name? Alright, so once you pick your character, you enter the dungeon. And just like Deep Dungeon, every single thing is inside the dungeon in this game. You start off in the town, and yes, it's another town inside the dungeon, and wander around looking for potential party members to join you. The dungeon walls look pretty good, but they seem to be sort of like covered in like a rattan surface or something like that. Not really sure who decorates dungeons. So I ran into this guy who's a monk. I give him the symbol, say, hey, you know, let's not fight, and he'll automatically join your party. We can say yes or no there whether you want him to join or not. Basically, you repeat this until you have a full party. Okay, so I've got five guys here, so let's go fight some monsters. At this point, you can't buy anything, because you have, as of yet, no gold. There's a whole shop just for caftans. So the first challenge is to find your way out of the town into the real dungeon, and this will not be easy. Super Black Onyx is a first-person dungeon crawler with no map, and every hall looks pretty much exactly alike. And every five steps, you'll run into another aspiring party member. And it's interesting, all the shops here only sell one thing. Why can't there be like a general armor and weapons store like every other RPG? So eventually, after wandering around aimlessly forever, you might get lucky and find the door that takes you to the dungeon. Then you'll fight monsters. Now the battle system is weird. Note those bars below your names? Those are your life, dexterity, and strength bars. Yes, I know it doesn't say that, but that's what they are. To fight, you select the fight icon from your party leader, then everyone will throw their weapons one at a time. Hopefully the weapon will hover in midair for a sec. If so, hit the A button and you will hopefully hit the opponent. Hit it multiple times and you might get in more than one hit. You might not get any hits at all. You can also use magic and whatnot. Unfortunately, nothing is labeled. Instead of words, the game uses a series of sort of very similar looking little icons for your spells and whatnot. And of course, naturally, battles occur about every five steps. So, Black Onyx, the original game, is sometimes considered to be the first Japanese RPG. I don't know if I agree with that. It was a Western-style RPG created by a Westerner who just happened to be living in Japan. So maybe Dragon Slayer was the first real Japanese RPG? Assuming you even consider Dragon Slayer to be an RPG? Well, at any rate, Super Black Onyx is far from perfect. The interface is painful to use, it really could use some labels. And this is a game where you spend countless hours walking down non-distinct hallways, fighting protracted battles with generic characters. If that is your sort of thing, I'd say take a look. It's pretty clear that Famicom developers are plotting to drive me crazy. I was just complaining about baseball games, and next episode we have two more baseball games. On the other hand, we've got two very interesting sports games, and they aren't even golf or baseball games. But best of all, we have a much-loved classic from Capcom. I hope I'll see you then.